What I'm going to talk about is the changing New England landscape. And if you look on the board for a moment, I'm going to try to race through a lot of slides in the brief amount of time that I have and look at stages of human impact on the New England landscape, ranging from the Paleo-Indians of about 10,000 years or so ago up until modern times. And then also try to look at signs of disturbance. So that the next time you're out walking in the woods or in the forest, you can put on your Sherlock or Shirley Holmes caps and play detective in terms of asking yourself what happened here and reading the New England landscape or the New England forest for signs of some of these historic events. Why do we care about this? To understand, one can argue, the present, it's really important to understand the past. And if we don't look at what has happened in the past, we, one could argue, will be endlessly destined to repeat the mistakes of the past. And I think it's really interesting to look at the fantastic amount of change that New England has undergone with an eye toward how can we manage change from here on. I also think that understanding what has happened in the past really adds to our enjoyment of the present. To be able to walk through the woods and read the New England landscape really increases that level, I would argue, of our enjoyment of our walk. So hopefully we'll get through some of that that stuff today. I want to start off by going back, way back. Those of you that were here last Friday, we're not going to go that far back. But we're going to go back around 15,000 years or so ago to when humans first came into North America. And this is somewhat debatable. There are those people who put human migration into the Americas at about 40,000. I've heard 70,000 years ago. But orthodox archaeologists place humans coming across Beringia, or the Bering Land Bridge, from Asia. Orthodox views have them skirting in between ice sheets, the Laurentide ice sheet to the east and the Alaskan glacier on the west, somewhere again around 15,000 years ago. Remember, we still are in the midst of an ice age. A lot of the ice, a lot of the water is locked up in glaciers, which allow this whole area of land, which we call Beringia, to be out of the water and allow people who are hunters for the most part and gatherers also to be following big game out of Siberia, out of Asia, through the landscape. And this is really interesting because what folks found once they got through these glaciers were, you know, a fantastic continent, very different from what we see today, particularly in regards to the megafauna. Those of you following the newspaper, with the woolly mammoth that was just found intact by French scientists in the Siberian tundra, I believe. I mean, imagine being a hunter and gatherer coming into North America and finding just these fantastic creatures, woolly mammoths, mastodons with their straight trunks. These shots are from the Pratt Museum in Amherst, which is the best natural history museum in our area. If you ever get a chance, you've got to go there. And this, the megafauna really really ruled North America, not just the woolly mammoths and the mastodons, but huge bears that you could evidently walk under, horses, camels, giant sloths, all sorts of really, really cool stuff. Around 12,000 or so years ago, almost all of these large herbivores and carnivores go extinct. Kaput, they're gone. And it's interesting to speculate why that happened. Traditional thought has been that, well, the climate was changing. We're moving out of an ice age into an interglacial period. The climate was warming up. The environment was changing. And these animals were becoming very stressed to begin with. But again, along this time, we have the introduction, this is a titanotheres, also from the Pratt Museum. We have the introduction of a new super predator, which is humans. And it doesn't seem to me to be coincidental that evidence of the super megafauna in North America become extinct at around exactly the same time that orthodox views have people coming into North America, 10, 12,000 years ago. So when we think, and I think part of our mythology about native peoples is that they walked softly in the landscape, the noble Indian, if you will, with absolutely no ecological ramifications to their actions. And that does not seem to be true. In fact, if we're looking at Paleo Indians or pre-Native American Indians, we look at them probably contributing, if not causing, the extinction of this megafauna, of these huge beasts that roam the New England woods and roam North America, which is really interesting. These are some arrow points, some Clovis points, among other things found. Earliest evidence of New England humans is about 10,000 years ago in Ipswich, a place called Bull Brook. There's also been sites recorded in Montague, in Deerfield, in Chicopee, also dating about 10,000 years ago. One of my favorite in terms of the large carnivores out there was a saber-toothed cat. It ranged at least into Pennsylvania, if not into New England as well. And you can imagine Paleo Indians 10,000 years ago having to be very sophisticated as hunters, very intelligent in their hunting to be able to take on creatures such as this. This is again from the Pratt Museum, which is interesting. So again, Paleo Indians, how did they impact on the landscape? We have major hunting going on, contributing very early on to the extinction of the megafauna in North America. We're going to jump ahead quite a few years here and sort of go into much more of a modern era and look at Native American impact on the New England landscape. When Europeans were sailing the coast of the Americas in the 1500s, Native American populations were thriving. It's very unclear how many people were in New England pre-European contact. And we know European contact goes back at least 1,000 years, but let's put it at around 1500 when Europeans really began fishing the coast. And Samuel Champlain talking about very vibrant fishing villages. We probably had a population of 100,000 to 250,000 Native American Indians in New England at the time of European, or the beginning of European conquest. And if you can see here, we're sort of in the midst here of the Pecumtuck Confederacy along the Connecticut River Valley. A number of tribes banding together for mutual protection. The language was very similar. Algonquin was the spoken language among most of these tribes. We loosely call all of New England the woodland peoples. And their impact on the Native American landscape was intense. Again, when I was a kid, I used to think, oh golly, what, you know, how cool to be an Indian. You know, you just sort of go and shoot a deer every now and then. But the more research that's done, the more I think we realize the tremendous impact that Native peoples did have. By the time Europeans reached New England, it was a manipulated landscape. Okay, it was not this primeval forest. It was not a virgin landscape. It was a cultural landscape. People had been working the land for thousands of years. Native peoples extensively used fire, not just for heating and not just for cooking, but also as a way to manage the forest. And not just in New England, but out west as well. Fire was a major force in molding the landscape for Native peoples to use. They used fire to burn the forest, to increase grasses to grow for animal forage, for deer coming in, to enhance their hunting grounds. They used fire to clear the woods of underbrush so they could get a shot off. It's very difficult to hunt with a bow and arrow if you have very, very thick woods. They used fire to manage insect populations, to increase nut-producing trees like oak, like hickory, like chestnut. They used fire to sort of bring back early successional plants like blackberries and black raspberries. They used fire as a way to encircle animals, drive animals into certain area, burn certain forage areas so that animals would be driven to only foraging in areas to make hunting easier. They used fire as means of communication, as means to get rid of enemies, all sorts of things. Fire was a dominant force by Native Americans. Native Americans also, for the most part around here, were hunters and gatherers, particularly up in the north. But they also had a lot of agriculture going on as well. Native peoples used the Three Sisters, squash, corn, and beans, along with a number of other crops. But they did not have nearly the intensive agriculture that European peoples did. And it's interesting to speculate, why is it that Europeans took over North America rather than Native American Indians taking over Europe? And I just read a very interesting book called Guns, Germs, and Steel, which talk about the rise of the agricultural revolution in Eurasia and the ability of people in Europe and Asia to cultivate a whole lot of different foods which were not present in North America. In terms of seed crops, in terms of large grasses, Europe and Asia had them. North America did not. In terms of domesticated animals, Europe and Asia had them. Sheep, pig, cows, all originating over there. There were no domesticated animals in North America other than dogs because there were no native animals to domesticate. Okay, and that's an interesting concept because the rise of agriculture in Europe and Asia allowed populations to increase dramatically. They allowed populations to have segments of the population that didn't have to hunt or gather or farm for a living, but instead could become soldiers, could become craftspeople, could develop technology that could be used in exploiting other people. The rise in domesticated animals allowed Europeans to be resistant to a whole realm of diseases that originated with animals, like influenzas and poxes, those kinds of things. So that Europeans really had a head start in terms of technology, disease resistance, food production that far exceeded that of native peoples. This is a traveling lodge, one of the historic Deerfield recreations. Native peoples did not live in wigwams like this, but when they would travel, they would keep some of their deer skins and all. They would cut down poles and spend the night in these. Native peoples instead lived in what are called wetus or longhouses. This is out of Plymouth Plantation. Wetu, W-E-T-U. And Plymouth Plantation being an interesting place to see early colonial history as well as Native American history. Native peoples were devastated very early on by European diseases. Their lack of domesticated animals and their lack of resistance to European diseases made them fall prey in huge numbers to particularly smallpox, but influenzas, other poxes, tuberculosis, all of these, for the most part, not deliberately introduced by Europeans, in some cases deliberately introduced, like with Jeffrey Amherst, of which the town of Amherst is named after, who deliberately gave smallpox-infested blankets to tribes. 1615, the first wave of epidemics hit Native American peoples. And probably about 90% of Native American peoples were killed in that first wave of epidemics. Now you think about that. You know, if 90% of us were to die, the cultural, the economic, the social disruptions that caused. Without that disease wiping out Native peoples, it's interesting to speculate, would Europeans have gained a foothold in America? By the time the Pilgrims were landing in 1620, there were also already unburied skeletons. Plymouth Plantation was built on the side of an old Indian village with unburied skeletons, with stores of food left out because of this wave of epidemic. Of course, Pilgrims justified this as an act of God. Cotton Mather wrote that the plague destroyed great multitudes of the barbarous heathen to make way for the chosen people of God. No, that's not a U.S. Congress saying that. That's Cotton Mather, although I suppose it could be. But the Pilgrims coming into a altered landscape in 1620 already found evidence of forest succession, of the forest coming back following Native Americans being reduced in terms of population size from disease. Pilgrims and Europeans who followed brought with them a whole different style of living and a whole different philosophy of land use. Native Americans, for the most part, were hunters and gatherers and small shifting agriculturalists. They would move seasonally depending on where things were. In the spring with the salmon and shad run, they'd be at Turner's Falls. During the winter, they would move back into the woods where there were good deer yards so they could hunt. Europeans moved in with a sense of ownership of land and permanence of land. And they brought with them, in an attempt to recreate European methods of agriculture, they brought with them domesticated animals, and they brought with them European crops, the wheats and the millets and those sorts of grains. And this had a remarkable transformation of the landscape. 1675, 1676, the last Native American resistance to colonial rule was overcome during King Philip's War. King Philip or Metacomet was a Native American Indian, sachem, who attempted to unite tribes to drive Europeans out. He was close to successful. King Philip's War in 1675-76 was the costliest war in New England's history. More people died or were displaced as a result of King Philip's War than in any other war, which is interesting. Philip sacked Deerfield and Hadley and Hatfield and Springfield. They were talking about making a wall around Boston. And white Europeans were able to divide tribes to pit tribal animosities, to pit tribes against each other, and ultimately capture Philip and kill him in 1676, which really ended effectively Native American resistance to European occupation. Philip was beheaded, he was drawn and quartered, his head was stuck on a stake in Plymouth Plantation for 20 years as evidence of how not to mess with the European culture coming in. So along about the end of the 1600s, we really have Native American resistance really ending, back to Plymouth Plantation here. However, New England, where we live, is still not a, quote, safe place. Europe is recreating, North America is recreating wars that are being fought in Europe. And from the late 1600s up until the fall of Quebec in 1760, we have this period known as the French and Indian Wars. And France and England are contesting who is going to own North America. For the most part, New England tribes, seeing how they survived at the hands of English-speaking Europeans, aligned themselves with the French, and most of who is left in terms of the Native American population is allied with the French. In 1760, Quebec falls, and New England now becomes a, quote, safe place for white Europeans. We have driven off, we meaning they, have driven off the French, they've decimated the Indian populations, and now for the first time, it is a, quote, safe place for English-speaking Europeans. As a result, you have a booming in the population. New England, or southern New England population, increases from about 30,000 to 90,000 in a matter of years between 1760, the fall of Quebec, and the 1790s. And we enter into a period of intense subsistence farming. This is a farmhouse at Harvard Forest, built sometime after 1763 by the Sandersons, who again were attempting to recreate what they had in Europe. This eye toward permanence, this eye toward farming forever. Subsistence farming doesn't mean just that. You weren't just farming for yourself, and there was a lot of trade within villages. But for the most part, farmers were looking at 70 acres of land plus a woodlot for pasture land, for grazing their cattle, for farming, for orchards. Around 1800, with the booming of the population, with the Industrial Revolution just beginning and cities springing up like Worcester and Providence and Springfield and Hartford and, of course, Boston. We get a move from a subsistence agriculture, this is a diorama from the Harvard Forest, into what we can call market agriculture, the wholesale deforestation of the landscape. I'm a transplanted Marylander. I grew up in Maryland. When I came to New England, I thought, God, this is great. This is how it always has been. You know, we have this virgin Berkshire forest and this virgin Green Mountains. And this is not the case. This is what the landscape looked like. We had 70 to 80% of Massachusetts deforested in the early to mid 1800s. There weren't trees around. They weren't there. People had chopped everything down and intensively farming the landscape to feed these growing villages. In 1810, the French defeat Portugal. Who cares, you could ask. Well, there was an embargo of Portugal, and when that embargo was lifted in 1810, there is an ability now for America to import a specific type of sheep called Merino sheep, which is ideally suited toward a North American environment. And we become gripped with sheep fever here. And there's sheep everywhere. And it's people are making money from the meat, from the wool. They can drive their product to market. However, sheep, as John Muir says, are nothing more than hoofed locusts. And they can devastate the landscape. Like some of us, they do not know when to stop eating. And as a result, we have sheep overusing the landscape, overgrazing the landscape. We have farmers abusing and overusing the soil. At best, we have lousy soil in New England, with some exceptions, like the Connecticut River Valley, as a result of glacial Lake Hitchcock and glaciation. But for the most part, because of glaciation, we have very rocky soil. We have a very hilly terrain. We have very acidic and droughty soils, and it is very tough to make a living as a farmer. And it's amazing that people did it for as long as they did. But what happens is a series of events that drive farming away from New England. And about the 1830s, a number of things happen. One is someone invents a reaper. McCormick, who was a displaced Vermonter, invents this McCormick reaper, which is ideally suited toward harvesting grains in the opening West, or the Midwest, as we call it now, Ohio, Indiana, Illinois. The reaper could work flat lands very easy, but could not work our rolling, hilly New England landscape. In the 1830s, someone gets this great idea to dig a canal from western to eastern New York and opens up the West to a vast variety of goods now. Once farming begins in the Midwest, in the Ohio Valley, we simply, as New Englanders, cannot compete. And our New England economy, based on agriculture, begins to crumble. In the 1860s, one out of every two native-born Vermonters had fled Vermont. Vermont did not get its population of the 1840s back until the late 1980s. The railroads come in the 1830s and the 1840s, again, allowing this flood of Western goods to come in to market, and people begin fleeing the New England countryside because you can't make a living off of it. What we get now is a return to forest. Nature abhors a vacuum. And it's not long once you leave something, you leave a plot unattended. Those of you that garden are well aware of this. That things come back. And with the collapse of agriculture in the mid-1800s, we have a return to forest. Now remember, things are still much less wild, if you will, in the mid-1800s than they are now. Beaver and most fur-bearing animals had been hunted to extinction in the late 1600s. Wolves were gone. Coyotes had not come in to take their place. White-tailed deer in the late 1800s, if someone saw one, was front page news, which is really interesting. Bald eagles, of course, gone. All of these animals extirpated from our system. We have a very much manipulated, human-manipulated landscape, which begins to change around mid-1800s with the collapse of agriculture, with secondary succession, with the movement now of trees back into abandoned fields, and in this case, abandoned orchards. White pine is a tree that is very dry-sided, that does very well in disturbed soils, that is sun-tolerant and shade-intolerant. In the mid-1800s, as people abandoned their farms and their fields, we have extensive forests of white pine moving into our New England landscape. And this is fast-growing stuff that along about the turn of the century, people realize are very valuable. 1920, you would clear cut 100 acres of white pine for $30,000. I mean, that's really pretty good, $1920. So people sitting now on what had become very valueless landscape. A lot of land ownership changed hands in the late 1800s. People now sitting on what were extensively white pine plantations are now in a position of cutting down white pine and selling it to make boxes and barrels and crates for all of these goods that continue to be shipped to us from the West. How are you going to ship food stuff from the West? Well, you need something to ship them in. We can supply that in terms of white pine. So we enter now into what I call the sawmill era. Portable sawmills had been invented where you could go in and clear off all of this white pine. Now, there wasn't extensive white pine plantations. There were deciduous trees thrown in here as well. And when you clear cut anything, stuff is going to come back pretty quickly. Hardwoods, like our maples and our oaks, do something that conifers, like white pine, do not. And that is when they are cut down, they stump sprout, or sometimes root sucker. So when you came in the early 1900s, and were clearing out the white pine, which had done so well with the abandonment of fields and pastures, we are moving from a white pine-dominated forest into a deciduous-dominated forest. Why? Because deciduous trees can get a jump start on white pine. They can stump sprout. White pines can't. Remember I said that white pines are very shade intolerant. Okay, so once you get deciduous trees coming up, they promote themselves and prohibit white pine regeneration. This is a forest, again at Harvard Forest, that was a pine plantation that was clear cut about 5 years before this picture was taken. And you can see deciduous trees coming up very strong with very few pine trees. They simply cannot compete. So we really move now into a forest that looks very similar to what it does today. We still have our white pines and our hemlocks, but for the most part, we're looking at a birch, maple, oak, a hickory-dominated forest. With our maple trees, stately maple trees, which all these New Yorkers are continuing to clog our roads to look at, sugar maple giving us our maple syrup, obviously, oak trees, which is such a great forage for animals, the stately beech trees with their about the only smooth-barked tree you see around. Birch, which white birch reaching about their southernmost point. They're much more of a northern forest hardwood, but we certainly see a lot of them down here as well. As well as our hemlocks and our white pines. Often an understory of, I'm spacing, what is this? Thank you, mountain laurel, hello. An understory of mountain laurel. The Connecticut state flower, I believe, likes acidic soils and does well. So we move into, following again the sawmill era and the reforestation, we move into a landscape that now is very different from what it was 150 years ago. We're back to a forested landscape. Now I have down here in my stages that that's not the last thing. We're really moving into modern times, if you will. And Massachusetts now, even though we're still about 70% forested, unlike 160 years when we were 70% cleared, is beginning to lose a lot of land now to development. Let me just read this to you. 1.23 million acres of land in Massachusetts is already developed. That's about 24% of the Commonwealth. So we're still about 75% undeveloped, which is pretty spectacular. But between 1972 and 1996, population increased 6% in Massachusetts. Developed land increased 59%. So we are really now in a point where we're reversing that trend. And it's not farming that is doing the reversing, but it's industrialization, it's businesses, it's commercial enterprises as well. Massachusetts Audubon has just come out with a document called Losing Ground, which is an interesting thing if folks want to take a look at it, which is an analysis of this rates and patterns of development and sort of raising the alarm call for if we want to still have a Massachusetts that is so heavily forested, we need to be really actively encouraging the preservation of open space. Okay, let's switch to the board here. We're going to switch from stages of human impact to how can we read the woods? And this is something that I find a lot of fun to do and has really opened my eyes to increasing my enjoyment in walking the New England woods. We are famous throughout the world for our stone walls. We have more miles of stone walls in New England than there are miles of railroad in the United States, which is interesting. And it's fascinating when you're walking around in places that seem so inhospitable, so rocky and so hilly, to think about human impact, to think about some of the lives that people led in terms of manipulating the landscape and putting up stone walls. For the most part, we tend to think of stone walls as colonial in origin and having a function to either demarcate property lines, to serve as ways to keep animals in or out. But there are some interesting structures throughout New England that sort of defy easy description or easy analysis. And this is a controversial thing, but we'll go through this quickly. A number of places in New England that we'll call stone chambers, which a number of people think predate colonial use. They are found throughout New England, lots in Massachusetts, lots in our area here. And there are, generally speaking, four schools of thought as to who made these and why they were made. Traditional Orthodox archaeology has these as Native American root cellars. We certainly see a lot of root cellars around to store root crops, to store a whole variety of different things. And clearly Native Americans use these as root cellars. There is a school of thought that has these as European made, but predating Columbus by about 500 years. There are stone chambers in Shutesbury that are called the Monk's Caves. These are labeled such because there is some thought that Irish Coldy monks, who were a seafaring people, came to North America about 1,000 years ago. Why they would go to Shutesbury and build something like this is a little unclear. But nonetheless, there's a lot of real interest in this, and there's a lot of camps that really agree with this, that New England had permanent European settlements 1,000 years ago. This is the archaeological fringe. A number of other people see these as evidence of Native American structures that predate colonial America as well. This is not New England, but Native Americans have a history of using stonework for villages, for temples, for sacred sites. This is Anasazi ruins in Chaco Canyon, I believe, in New Mexico. And there are a number of different sites that seem to perhaps have been built by Native Americans. This is the only commercial stone chamber site in New England. It's in Salem, New Hampshire. It's called America's Stonehenge, to try to capitalize on that. But a lot of these stone chambers seem to have astronomical significance. They have rocks and standing stones and entrances of chambers that are oriented celestially for the solstices, for the equinoxes. The winter solstice for peoples in the northern hemisphere have been looked upon as a sacred holiday or sacred day. The woodland tribes, Algonquin people, looked at the winter solstice as the day of the dead. This was when you could communicate with your dead relatives. And there are a number of stone chambers that are oriented so you can watch the sun rise or set on the winter solstice, which is interesting. Native American peoples also have a history of marking sacred sites by bending saplings very early on to point toward where sacred sites are. And this is a tree, it's called a pointer tree, in Putney, Vermont, which is pointing toward one of these really interesting stone chambers. Whether or not that's true, who knows? But it's interesting to speculate that not all stonework is colonial in origin, but some, in fact, may be Native American. This is back to that Salem developed site. The last school of thought regarding these stone chambers is that they were put here by aliens, which seems to be the only clearly rational one. As an X-File watcher, I'm sure that's actually the case. But these things are everywhere, and I've made it sort of a habit of mine to go and seek these things out, and the seeking is a lot of fun because you can't often figure out exactly where they are. For the most part, however, stone walls do tell the history of colonial America. And I want to race through ways to look at some of the stone walls and really figure out what happened here. I'm at Quabbin here. I'm standing on this wall looking down. This is a little hard to see, but we have a really large stone wall. We call this a double stone wall, where we have large, big rocks, as well as, and it's a little difficult to see with the pine needles there, but fist-sized stones as well. Okay. If you had large rocks in a wall, you're either thinking property marker or grazing. Okay, I mean, those were the two reasons why most stone walls were built. However, a lot of these stone walls that are double like this with small rocks in the middle are built because there were farming activities on one side of the wall or another. No one in their right mind is going to build a wall with fist-sized rocks. Imagine the work that would take. But if you're running a plow through the land and you hit a small rock, you can do as much damage as you're going to get if you hit a big rock. So when you see a wall with small fist-sized stones, think farming. Okay. When you see barbed wire like this, obviously we're thinking pasture. And barbed wire was not invented, if you will, until the early 1870s. So if you see barbed wire within a stone wall or next to a stone wall, got to be thinking grazing. And for the most part, you would never see barbed wire used to demark properties like sometimes you see it today. So old barbed wire, think of as grazing. Another good sign of grazing is the presence of juniper. Juniper is an unpalatable, in this case, low shrub that is very uncompetitive with any kind of other vegetation. For the most part, you're going to naturally see juniper in very poor quality soils or around rocky ledges, those kinds of places. If you're out in the woods and you come across a place where there is juniper, you also have to be thinking pasture. That it was able to get a foothold within a pasture, survive browsing by animals because it's so thorny and it's so unpalatable. So again, you want to be thinking grazing there. Wolf trees are another good sign of grazing. Trees are in competition for light with each other. They go out, they go up rather than out. If you're out in the woods and you see a tree that looks like this, this would not happen in a forest setting. Okay? Other trees would be crowding in and would be interfering with this, with the ability of this tree to go horizontal rather than vertical. See a tree like this, again, think grazing. Okay, this is a sign of a pasture. These are called wolf trees. They were left in fields to shade animals. Why they're called wolf trees is a little unclear. It may be because they stand alone like a wolf. It may be because wolves would come to wolf trees because a lot of sheep would be seeking the shade around them. Who knows? But anyway, that's what.
Is that high ledges there?
Very good. That is high ledges. Yeah.
It's a beautiful tree.
Yeah, it is a beautiful tree. Apples are not native to New England, nor are the bees that pollinate apples. Apples came over with early colonists. When you're out walking in the woods and you see an apple tree, okay, you want to think colonial orchard for the most part. Maybe not colonial orchard, but some sort of orchard. These trees cannot get established in the midst of a forest. Again, they really require light. They do very poor in shade. So
old apple trees like this, think old orchard. But for the most part, what we're looking at is just some of our beautiful stone walls. This is at Quabbin and Dana Center. Remember how I said no one in their right mind would take fist-sized stones and make a wall out of them? This is one exception, and it was really done not to, not as a property boundary or to keep animals in or out, but as decoration for a house. This is up in Catamount. Catamount and Coleraine is full of a variety of just beautiful stone walls on very inhospitable terrain, very, very rocky terrain. And the human history of Catamount is very interesting. This is shot is a little difficult to see, but I'm standing at the open end of a three-sided stone structure. When you see a three-sided stone structure like this, you want to think barn, okay? And this is what this is. This is an old barn, again, on very rocky, very hilly terrain. Foundations, obviously, call our attention to the human inhabitants that were there. And foundations really are everywhere. And just the, again, the hilliest type of habitat. And when you go up into some of these places, I always ask myself, how did these people live? How could you farm or survive in such poor quality, rocky, acidic soil? It's really a tribute to humans to be able to survive there at all. I'm a little obsessed with stonework. Okay, enough already. Yeah, okay. Other signs of human manipulation of the landscape. One of the most obvious, perhaps, is logging. You know, you see a cut stump, we're going to think logging, obviously. Number of other signs of logging as well. Remember we talked about when hardwoods are cut, they multiple trunk. Okay, they stump sprout, or sometimes root sucker, and multiple trunk. This is not a natural thing for trees to do, for the most part. If you're out walking in the woods, and you see extensive multiple trunking like this, and if there's any evidence of cut stumps at all, you're going to think logging, clear cutting, whatever. Also with logging, you're looking at fairly even age stands. If it's a clear cut, everything's going to come back pretty much at once. So multiple trunking, cut stumps, even age stands, all evidence of logging. Occasionally you'll be out in the woods and you'll see some sort of basal scarring on the sides of trees, some of the larger trees that were left. When skidders or loggers are going in removing trees, they'll sometimes scar the sides of trees, and that's another good way to be looking for signs of logging. Fire, whether deliberately set by humans or whether set by nature in terms of lightning storms, as this is, lightning strike, have also been a major player in the New England landscape. Not as much as perhaps out west, but nonetheless, fires have roared through here periodically. Signs of fire. Often when you have sort of a low intensity fire that's zipping through a forest, you're going to have accumulation of leaf litter, leaf debris, on the base of trees. And a fire that's sort of moving in and allowing the tree to survive may be burning this accumulated leaf litter on the bottom of trees. And you'll see signs sometimes of this basal scarring like this. Charcoal is another good sign of fire, but charcoal, evidence of charcoal decreases fairly rapidly, like within about 10 years for surface charcoal. The black stuff that we're looking at here is actually not charcoal, but a fungus. So you always want to be careful when you're looking and you're thinking that it might be signs of a fire, that it's actually not a black fungus instead. One of the ultimate in basal scarring, this is back at Dana Center in Quabbin, where this tree really, really scarred through fire on the bottom, but still miraculously enough survived. Wind. With all the hurricane stuff in the news lately, we tend to minimize the impact that wind has had in New England, because for the most part, hurricanes are much more of a southeastern phenomena in the United States. Nonetheless, hurricanes do roar through here regularly. We've had intense hurricane damage. The 1938 hurricane was one of the most devastating and just leveled whole tracts of forest in central New England. Signs of wind damage. This is actually a bent red pine. Evidently, this was blown down during the 38 hurricane and came back up, retaining that bend, which is interesting that you can still see that after so many years. For the most part, signs of wind damage will look something like this, where we have individual trees down. A good sign of wind damage is when you see very bumpy terrain. As trees are blown down with their root ball and all, you'll have the root ball begin to decompose, leaving what I call a pillow. And where the root ball came out on the other side of this is a depression, which is called a cradle, pillow cradle topography. Very bumpy ground like this. Good signs or good indication of wind damage. And if you're really good at this, you can take a look at this and you can see what direction the wind came from, depending on where the pillows are in relation to their cradles. You can sometimes tell on the basis of decomposition when this wind event occurred. If we have a circular pattern, you can look at maybe a tornado touching down. So, interesting things. This is a little difficult. I'm on the Allegash River in northern Maine. I'm in the canoe. I'm looking out at an area that had a significant wind event. A tornado roared through here. It's hard to see, but you can see the hardwoods, and then, I'm sorry, the softwoods up here, the firs and the spruces, and then hardwoods regenerating along the path of the tornado that swept through here about 40 years before. I'm racing through this with time. A few more minutes. Okay. Blight is another major issue. We have been infested by a number of different blights in our recent and not so recent past. I think most people have heard of the American chestnut blight caused by a fungus. This is an American chestnut stump here. And this is actually the fungus that girdles the trees. American chestnuts were one of the dominant trees. One out of four hardwoods were American chestnut at the turn of the century. One out of two hardwoods in some of the southern, southeastern forest were American chestnuts. Beeches, American elms, white pines have all been devastated by forest pathogens, in this case fungus. Insect damage also causes a lot of disruption or disturbance to the New England environment. Including gypsy moss, biggest outbreak in 1981. I remember walking through the forest and it sounded like it was raining with gypsy moth poop, just raining down on you. Woolly adelgid now, which is an insect that is devastating hemlocks and is really moving up now into western Massachusetts. And of course, our last signs of disturbance are not human manipulators of the environment, but the major non-human manipulators, which are beavers. With the prohibition of leghold trapping, we've seen a real rise in beavers in Massachusetts and a real increase in some of the not so pleasant interactions between beavers and humans. Beavers building dams to manipulate their environment do a remarkable job in really changing things so they can allow the building of lodges, the flooding of areas. We have more beavers here now than we may have ever had before. And we'll see what happens with this one. This is a tough one. I think I'm giving the signal here, which means I'm out of town. But coincidentally, that's also the end of my slideshow, so that's good.